What exactly was it about this movie that had moviegoers the world over blowing chunks into their bags of popcorn? An old legend of cinema goes that the pioneering Lumiere brothers' 1896 film, The Arrival of a Train, had new-to-the-media moviegoers scrambling in a panic to flee from an on-screen locomotive as it pulls into a train station. Because the camera is situated at the end of the platform, it looked like the train would burst through the screen. While there's no hard evidence that the incident ever happened, the story illustrated how effective camera work can be in disrupting a viewer's perception to the point of emotional and physical extremes. Thus, audiences and their sense of equilibrium have been hostage to genre films ever since. Fast forward to 2007, when producer and director J.J. Abrams decided America needed its own monster that wasn't King Kong. The result was Cloverfield, a clever mashup of a kaiju thriller with a found footage horror movie. Set in New York City as a cluster of 20-somethings at a farewell party capture a large-scale monster attack, the story is presented via personal camcorder, with nary a Steadicam gimbal in sight. While adding to the story's authenticity, the cinematography results in the dreaded shaky cam effect found footage movies are now known for, prompting widespread reports of motion sickness among audience members at the film screenings. But why? Well, as it turns out, all that retching and misery have a pretty straightforward scientific explanation. So, why does Matt Reeves' Cloverfield make folks lose their lunch? It's just a bit of visual side-to-side for 85 minutes straight. Which isn't disorienting at all, right?
I don't feel so good.
Okay, yeah, it is pretty bad. University of Toronto professor Bob Chung, who examines motion sickness at the Institute's Department of Physiology, points at mind-body confusion as the root cause of what he calls, quote, simulated sickness. About 15 to 20% of people have an inner ear abnormality that can make them sensitive to a specific bit of sensory input, Chung told the Toronto Star. Because it was filmed from a first-person perspective, the optic flow is coming toward you, making you feel like you are moving forward when in fact you are sitting in a chair. This sensory conflict is between what your eyes are visually telling you and what your other sensors that govern orientation are telling you. Some people are able to resolve this very quickly, and some can't. So what solutions are available? Short of popping a Dramamine before the show begins, one answer is to sit at the back of the theater. Cinephiles may balk at the idea, but Chung recommends limiting immersion with the screen and disrupting the optic flow by simply sitting as far away as possible. It works in the same way motion sickness does during car rides, focusing on static, faraway objects rather than repetitive, close stuff like trees and lampposts can keep the queasiness at bay. It's not exactly how Christopher Nolan would want a viewer to engage with his movies, but if it works, it works. Cloverfield is far from the only offender when it comes to simulated sickness. Movie Hurl, a site that rates movies according to their motion sickness factor, lists Cloverfield as a Hall of Shamer, an honor given to the most commonly cited films that churn the stomach. But the film is only at the number 6 spot. The movie with the worst nausea rating had a fraction of the Cloverfield budget, but had audiences reaching for barf bags all the same. The Blair Witch Project was a 90s indie picture that had its captive audiences too scared to close their eyes and too sick to open them. Following a trio of film students armed with cameras in pursuit of a local legend, the directors used a bit of the old and new for their sick-making, subjecting viewers to shaky footage via 16mm film and a Sony Hi8 camcorder. The New York Post reported on waves of upset stomachs and dizziness at screenings across the country, but the film's worldwide gross of over $248 million heralded a rise in found footage fare, one that would yield pop culture heirs like Blumhouse's Paranormal Activity and Barry Levinson's shaky cam mockumentary, The Bay.